Hi, welcome to MooMooMath. Today we are going to look at some questions for the EOC assessment at the end of analytical geometry. So here is item one from the state website. So in this figure, L and M, the two lines, are parallel to each other. Jessie listed the first two steps in a proof of angle 1 plus angle 2 plus angle 3 is equal to 180 degrees. So you can see angle 1, 2, and 3 are inside a triangle, and you're trying to prove that, okay? In order to justify that, we need to show that angle 2 and angle 4 are also congruent, okay? Because if 1 and 4, see angle 1, angle 4, and angle 5, all three of those create a linear pair that adds up to 180. If we can show that angle 4 and 2 are congruent and 3 and 4, 5 are congruent, then we know that the triangle is congruent too. But in order to get there, we need to show that angle 4 and angle 2 are congruent and angle 3 and angle 5 are congruent. Okay, we're told that L and M are parallel, so I'm going to mark my diagram. Now, how do we know that angle 5 and angle 3 and angle 2 and angle 4 are congruent? Well, if you look, the side VT and the side VU create transversals, and these become alternate interior angles. So let's go down and look at our possible choices. Which justification can Jessie use to give for steps 1 and 2? Are they alternate interior angles, corresponding angles, vertical angles, or alternate exteriors? Well, those are alternate interiors because they fall between the two lines, and they're alternate means they're on opposite sides of the transversal. Okay, item 2. Let's read it. It says, this table defines a function with x values making up the domain and y values making up the range. So here's our input, our domain. Here's our output, our range. Which equation describes this function? So we're trying to match this table to all the equations. So let's zoom in just a little bit, try to get a better look at this. Okay, this is how I would do it. Remember, this is a multiple choice test. So it's one of these four choices. What I need to do is just start plugging in values. All these values have to work in these equations where these are my inputs and these are my outputs. So I'm going to look carefully and I'm going to probably choose 0 because it's so easy to plug in. So I'm going to plug in when x is 0, y is 4. So let's try that point and see if we can eliminate some of our choices. If I plug in 0 into the first function, what do I get out? I get out 4. So it could be that one. Okay, let's try B. If I plug in 0, do I get out 4? No, 0 times 4, that's 0. If I plug in 0 into the third one, so we know it's not B. If I plug in 0 to this one, that's 0 minus 1 is negative 1. And if I plug in 0 into the last one, I get 0 squared is 0, 4 times 0, I get negative 4. So the only one that works for the point 0, 4 is the first one. So that's got to be my solution. Now I can double check it by plugging in some other x values. If I plug in negative 2, negative 2 quantity squared times, that's 4. And then it's got a negative in front, so negative 4 plus 4, yeah, that's 0, so that one works. So I'm just kind of spot checking these, and they're working. So I know that A is my answer. Now, let's look at second page, which is problems 3 and 4. Okay, problem 3 is a circle problem. This one's actually really easy. Okay, you've got the measure of arc QR. I'm going to label my diagram. That's 72 degrees. And we're asked to find the measure of angle QPR. So that's Q to P to R. So I want to know what this angle is. Well, this is what we call an inscribed angle. And the rule is it's half of the half of the arc. So if this is 72, then this angle must be half of it, which is C, 36. So that inscribed angle, just so you can reference it, is equal to 1/2 the measure of the arc. Not mark, half the measure of the arc. So hopefully that will help. Okay, and then here's the fourth one. And we're going to stop after this and I'll make a video of 5, 6, 7, and 8. But here's item 4. Which of these expressions has a real number value? Okay, a real number value, that means it can't be imaginary. So let's look at our choices. The first choice is 1 over I. It's really hard to read this, so I'm going to rewrite it. It's 1 divided by I. Well, anytime you have an imaginary, it's not a real value. So it's definitely not that one. Okay, B is negative I. Okay, again, we've got an imaginary number, and it can't be, that one's not a real number. Now we have the square root of negative I, or square root of I. Well, if you know I is the value negative 1. So we're taking the square root of a negative. That is not real, is it? That one's not a real answer. So it's definitely not that one. So I squared. Okay, well, the value of I is negative 1. If I take negative 1 and I square it, what do I get? I get negative 1 times negative 1, and that gives me positive 1. So there we go. I is equal to the square root of negative 1. So if I square that and I square the square root of negative 1, I get I is equal to negative 1, which is a real, I squared is equal to negative 1. So because a square and a square root cancel. So that does give me a real answer because negative 1 is a real number. So let me go back to C for just a second. To evaluate that, I'm going to take the square root of I, and I is the square root of negative 1. So really, we're taking the square root of the square root of negative 1, which is really negative 1 to the 1/4 power, which we know definitely is not a real answer. So the only choice would have to be D. When you square the square root of negative 1, you get negative 1, which is the real answer. Hopefully this video is helpful on going through those first 4 questions.